بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهداه، أما بعد. My dearly respected brothers and sisters, tonight we continue with the explanation of Kitab al-Tawheed from Sahih al-Bukhari, and we are currently in the chapter which speaks about the Amr of Allah Azza wa Jal, or the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We take the hadith of Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa ardah, where he said, قال سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول لا يزال من أمتي أمة قائمة بأمر الله ما يضرهم من كذبهم ولا من خالفهم حتى يأتي أمر الله وهم على ذلك. In this hadith, the hadith of Muawiyah رضي الله تعالى عنه, he says, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam say that a group of my followers will continue following Allah's laws strictly, and they will not be harmed by those who disbelieve them or stand against them until the amr of Allah, until Allah's order will come, while they will be in that state. So this hadith is one of the famous ahadith which has a number of narrations that speaks about the saved sect or the victorious group that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says لا يزال من أمتي أمة, that there will remain from my ummah an ummah, from my ummah there will be an ummah. The word ummah here refers to a jama'ah of people, a group of people. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is speaking about a group of people from amongst his ummah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily we sent to every ummah a messenger. Allah says in the Quran, we sent to every ummah a messenger. So ummah is referring to a group of people. And it's a group of people who are joined together. They are joined either by religion. So when a group of people have the same religion, they are an ummah, like the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So an ummah is a group of people either joined by religion, or they are joined by a time and a place. Because the word ummah can refer to everyone who's living at the time or place, whether they're Muslim or non-Muslim and whatever else, you can call it an ummah. But the specific ummah, the ummah that answered the call, refers only to the ummah of Islam. And here in this hadith, it refers to millah, religion. As Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran regarding Quraysh, what did they used to say? We found our fathers on a ummah. So we are on that ummah, meaning a religion. Our fathers were on a religion, so we are on that religion. So the word ummah can have different meanings. Just like the word ummah can refer to a imam or a great figure who is followed, the word ummah can apply even to one man who is followed. That's why Allah Azza wa Jal called the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam an ummah. Why? Because he's followed as an example. So Allah Azza wa Jal referred to Ibrahim alayhi salam as an ummah. And this hadith, my brothers and sisters, the meaning of the hadith is that there will always, and when the Prophet ﷺ says always, ما يزال means forever, always remaining, a group, a jama'a, from this ummah who are upon the truth. So the truth in the ummah never dies. It never disappears. There will always remain people on the haqq. Because this is a promise from Allah and His Messenger. They will remain upon the truth and they are victorious, mansurin, until the Amr of Allah comes. Meaning the hour, or as we mentioned in our previous lesson, until the wind takes their soul. Because as we know, the Day of Judgment, no believer witnesses it. No Muslim witnesses the Day of Judgment. Allah takes the soul of the believers by sending a wind. He said, the wind is smoother than silk and it smells greater than musk. So Allah gathers the believers, takes their soul, and then the Day of Judgment takes place. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, the hour is not established except on the worst of people. So there are no believers when Allah Azza wa Jal brings the Day of Judgment. And the fact that there is a group from the ummah who will always remain on the truth, this is a fadl, this is a virtue, a reward from Allah Azza wa Jal for this ummah. That the truth will remain forever no matter what. No matter how many people are against it. No matter how many enemies fight it, the truth will always exist and it will always be victorious and it will always prevail. No matter the amount of enemies and how hard they work, this is a promise from Allah Azza wa Jal. So this group of people who the Prophet ﷺ said will remain victorious until the hour, he said, they will not be harmed by those who disbelieve them or stand against them. This group, this victorious group, they will never be harmed by those who disbelieve them or stand against them. And that is from Allah's victory and His support for this religion. And from Allah's signs is that this ummah is victorious regardless of the enemies. Regardless of how much they plot and plan against the deen continues, walillahil hamd, and it will always prevail. And we witness this with our own eyes. If we look at the plotting and the planning and the yani attack against Islam as a religion that exists today, the enemies of Islam are going full force, spending their wealth and their propaganda and whatever else to try to diminish and to try to put out the light of Allah Azza wa Jal. But as Allah says, His light will remain even if the disbelievers hate it. And we witness this. As hard as they try, Islam flourishes like a flower. And people continue to embrace Islam in huge numbers. Because Allah has promised that the deen will always be victorious. So this group, this firqa, the people of haqq, they are not harmed by those who disbelieve them or stand against them. Those who disbelieve them, meaning the open non-Muslims. The disbelievers who stand against the people of truth are not harmed by those who disbelieve in them from the open non-Muslims. He said, and stand against them. This phrase here, they are not harmed by those who disbelieve or stand against them. The ones who stand against the people of truth, this is mainly referring to those who are from the same religion, but they stand against the people of truth. And how much does this exist today? You find people ascribed to Islam from the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but they attack and they stand against the people of truth. If you call to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will find enemies from within your own Ummah. If you speak in the Kitab and the Sunnah, you will find people who stand against you. If you speak that this is halal and this is haram, you will find people standing against you and calling you and labeling you names. But the Prophet ﷺ is saying about this group of people that they are not harmed by those who disbelieve them or stand against them. And this group, when the Prophet ﷺ says a firqa, a group, a ta'ifa, this does not mean that they are all physically together as a group at once. Rather, they can be scattered all across the world. You can have part here and some here and some there and some there. So when the Prophet ﷺ says there will always be a group, it doesn't mean that they're physically a group who are all together at once. No. They can be in different areas of the world. And they can be doing different types of work as well. From this group could be mujahideen, and from the group could be ulama and righteous worshippers and supporters of the religion and people who give and spend their wealth in the path of Allah and so forth. For this group is not specified to a type of people from the ummah. It can have many different types, but they all agree on the concept of Islam and on the aqidah of Islam and on the teachings of Islam. There is no doubt regarding this. And Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah has used this hadith because of the words where the Prophet ﷺ said, until the amr of Allah reaches them. They remain victorious until the amr of Allah reaches them. The command of Allah. And he used it to show that the command of Allah is not from the creation. Because this whole chapter is put by Imam al-Bukhari to prove that Allah's word, his command, is not part of his creation because it comes from him. But the creation is the outcome of his command. So when Allah orders something to happen, that order is not created. But the outcome of the order is the creation. This is what Imam al-Bukhari is teaching us in this chapter. We then move on to the next hadith, the hadith of Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, where he said, عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال وقف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على مسيلمة في أصحابه فقال لو سألتني هذه القطعة ما أعطيتكها ولن تعدو أمر الله فيك ولئن أدبرت ليعقرنك الله ليعقرنك الله. Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood in front of Musaylama al-Kadhab. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood in front of Musaylama al-Kadhab, who was sitting with his companions. And then the Prophet ﷺ said to him, if you asked me even for this leaf of a palm, Prophet ﷺ said to Musaylam al-Kadhab, if you asked me even for this leaf, I would not give it to you. Then he said to him, you cannot avoid what Allah has ordained for you. The Prophet said to Musaylama, you cannot avoid, you can't run away from what Allah has ordained for you. And if you turn away from Islam, Allah will surely ruin you. This is the hadith. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he mentioned this hadith in a number of chapters. And from them is the chapter Signs of Prophethood. And in the other chapters, Imam al-Bukhari mentions this hadith in its entirety. Here, the hadith is summarized. In the other chapters, he mentions it entirely. So what's the story with this hadith? Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he says in the hadith in the other chapter, that Musaylam al-Kadhab came in the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam with many of his people to Medina. First and foremost, who's Musaylam al-Kadhab? Musaylam al-Kadhab was a man from Yemen who had a group of followers that would follow him, and he claimed to be a prophet in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Musaylam al-Kadhab, he used to call himself Musaylam al-Sadiq, Musaylam the truthful, but the Prophet ﷺ called him Musaylam al-Kadhab, Musaylam the liar, because he was a liar. He used to claim to be a prophet. So this man, Musaylam al-Kadhab, who was initially and originally from Yemen, he came to Al-Madinah with some of his people who would follow him. And he said, if Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam makes me his successor, I will follow him. What did he say? He said, if Muhammad makes me the leader and the prophet after him, then I will follow Muhammad. MashaAllah. Look at this condition. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he heard this, he went to Musaylama with Thabit ibn Qais radiallahu anhu, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was carrying a leaf. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was carrying a piece of a date palm leaf in his hand. And that's when he stood in front of Musaylama and his companions, and he said to him, if you asked me even for a leaf, I would not give it to you. And you're asking me to make you the leader after me? If you asked me for a leaf, I'm not going to give it to you. Then he said, you cannot avoid the fate that Allah has destined to you. If you reject Islam, Allah will destroy you. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, I think that you are most probably the same person who I have seen in the dream. The Prophet said to Musaylama, I have a good feeling that you are the same person I have seen in my dream. So Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu told Ibn Abbas that the Prophet ﷺ said, while I was sleeping, I saw in a dream two gold bracelets around my arm. The Prophet ﷺ, he saw two gold bracelets around his arm. He said, and that worried me too much. Then I was instructed divinely from wahi in my dream to blow them off, to blow at the bracelet, to blow them off. So I blew them off and they flew away. The Prophet ﷺ said, I interpreted the two bracelets to be symbols of two liars who would appear after me. The Prophet ﷺ interpreted those two bracelets to be two liars who would appear. He said, one of them is Al-Anzi and the other is Musaylam Al-Kadhab from Yamama. So this is the hadith that Imam al-Bukhari has put. This event between the Prophet ﷺ and Musaylam al-Kadhab, it occurred right towards the end of Rasulullah's life. It occurred in the 10th year of Hijri, yani right before his death. And this narration, it clarifies why the Prophet ﷺ said these words to him. Because he was wanting the Prophet to pass leadership to him after him. And the Prophet ﷺ said to him, you cannot avoid the fate, the amr of Allah. And that's why Imam al-Bukhari used this hadith here. Again, it's talking about the amr of Allah, the command of Allah. The Prophet is telling Musaylama, you cannot avoid the command of Allah that he has destined for you. And that's why Imam al-Bukhari used this hadith. Then the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say to Musaylama? He said, if you reject Islam, Allah will destroy you. And this was from the miracles of the Prophet ﷺ. Why? Because it indeed happened. Not in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, after his death. Because we said this happened right before the Prophet's death. And after the Prophet ﷺ passed away, as we know, the great Siddiq radiallahu anhu, Abu Bakr, took the Khilafah. And part of Abu Bakr's Khilafah radiallahu anhu was that he sent out 11 armies to fight different types of people. One of those armies he sent to fight Musaylam al-Kadhab. And Musaylam al-Kadhab was killed in that battle from the army that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu sent to him. So when the Prophet ﷺ said to Musaylama, you cannot escape Allah's fate, Prophet ﷺ understood and he knew that Allah has decreed something and prepared something for Musaylama. And this is from the miracles of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And a fact is that the person who managed to kill Musaylam al-Kadhab in battle is the same man who killed Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu when he was a non-Muslim. And that's Al-Wahshi. Al-Wahshi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who's the man that killed Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. As we know, Al-Wahshi later on became a Muslim and he perfected his Islam. He went in that army to fight Musaylama, and he mentioned the story himself. He said, I killed the most beloved person to Rasulullah when I was a non-Muslim, and now I killed the most hated man to him. And it was like a repentance from him for that. Subhanallah, how Allah Azza wa Jal changes the hearts. This hadith is talking about the amr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, next week, my brothers and sisters, we will take the next hadith regarding this chapter. Bi-ithnillah. Wallahu a'lam. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
Al-Bayan Radio, the voice of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah.